Now, our next speaker for the discussion tonight is to give another nation's perspective on the project. The Russian President Putin has given a full endorsement of the project. There are many aspects of integration between Russia and China. There's been ongoing discussions between both President Xi Jinping and President Putin. I think our next speaker will give us a sense of that. This is the third time I've had a chance to work with Consul General Sergei Petrov. Just a little bit of background. He started his foreign work in Afghanistan, then he came to the U.S. Embassy in 1995, participated in the Foreign Office's North American desk, and he came to San Francisco in 2013. He speaks English, Farsi, and French, and he's a very good friend, I think, of the United States, and an important sinew for, hopefully, a better collaboration between the U.S. and Russia. I'll remind everyone in the room, it was Russian naval officers who helped put out the fire in San Francisco in the 1860s. They were key allies supporters of ours in the Revolutionary War, the Civil War, and that we fought alongside them both in World War I and World War II. So here's for better collaboration between the U.S. and Russia. Please give a warm welcome to Sergei General.
Thank you very much. Good evening, dear friends. I have to thank speakers, distinguished speakers before me, giving, I hope you, a very comprehensive idea of what the Belt and Road Initiative is. So, before I start, give you a Russian view on that, I have to thank the American Legion for bringing me here, and I'm honored to be with you. I have very high respect to veterans, no matter what country they represent, because they defend their motherland. Only 2 days ago, I was honored to be at the 90th anniversary of a Russian veteran here, who is the chairman of the veteran organization in San Francisco, Mr. Boris Moldavsky. So he was the one that, when he was 17 years old, he joined the Red Army and went to fight the Nazis. So thank you very much. And it's pretty symbolic that we are in a building that was the place where the UN Charter was signed many years ago. The organization was established that was supposed to prevent the new World War after the tragedy we had in the Second World War. And fortunately, with our joint collective efforts, we still live under peaceful, mostly peaceful sky. I would like to also recognize and thank Michael Stegner and Schiller's Institute and all his colleagues for organizing, for helping to organize this event and for bringing me here. Thank you very much. So what I was asked to speak about is how Russia views the Belt and Road Initiative. So if I put it in a very short way, that would be support and participate, contribute and benefit. That was exactly the message that was part of the joint statement by two presidents of China and Russia in May 2015, as well as it was reiterated lately when President Putin went to participate in the Belt and Road International Forum in Beijing last May. And it's not a tactical position of Russia, like you will probably read in some newspapers now that while relationship between Russia and the West became kind of chilly, Russia turned to the East and started working with China. That's wrong. We have been building our relationship that reached the strategic partnership level with China for decades. But let me put it. Let me put this initiative in a historic perspective. Distinguished speakers before me mentioned several times the old, well-known project, worldly well-known project, the Silk Road. It was definitely a project that helped to develop many regions in Eurasia, to help economy of China, of Europe, as well as many regions in between. But there was another project. It was called the Great Tea Road. It's not as well known as Silk Road, but that was another major thing that helped economic development. And interestingly, it was all very much related to Alaska and to California. You will ask how. Russia started exploring Alaska not just wanting to find new lands. One of the goals was to find a way to boost the economy of Russia, and for the Russian entrepreneurs to be successful and to get better profits. So they found a way. They came to Alaska and later to California, and they hunted for otter. Otter fur was very precious in Russia, but even more in China. So the otter fur was transported from Alaska and California to China, where it was sold. Then for the profit, for the money earned, tea was bought. And then this tea was brought to Moscow, St. Petersburg in Russia, as well as to Europe. So this operation, this business project at that time, would make a person very rich. It will take several years probably to do that, but it will make you a successful and rich businessman. But it's a historic perspective. If we speak about present day, wider perspective, we look at this initiative as a very logical development in the world that went through several economic crises, downfalls, stagnation. So we are facing another crisis of not just economic but social crisis where we cannot cope. Many countries in the world, even the richest countries, cannot cope with the growing, the exploding demand from people who want to raise their living standards. Some see that protectionism could help. Our view is that it's a dead end. We think that the open systems and project like One Belt, One Road is exactly the way out. And it's a good opportunity for everyone in the world to participate in this project and to profit. And by the way, I was mentioning to my colleague from the Chinese consulate that it would be a great opportunity for the US companies from California to participate in this, in many projects of Belt and Road Initiative with the exceptional modern, most modern technologies that they have. So we view it, as my president put it, as a truly civilization-wide project. It's the speakers before me mentioned that there are many things that make this project very useful. It will, the goal is to put the economies, not just Chinese economy, but many economies in the world, and to make more effective connections, interconnections between different countries. Actually, I think it has something in common, and my colleague mentioned NAFTA. I think that even before NAFTA, when this country built railways, and it was mentioned here, also railways that connected all the continent, and from west to east, then roads, automobile roads, and then connecting north to south with their neighbors, Canada and Mexico, that was a huge boost for the economy of this country and for the economy of this continent. And this actually made the United States as a driver for the world economy for many decades. And that was not the case in Eurasia, another continent. We still have many barriers, bureaucratic, geographical, political, on the Eurasian continent, and the Belt and Road Initiative, if it happens and if it helps to connect different parts of Eurasia and then from Eurasia to other parts of the world through rail, through road, automobile roads, through marine transportation, that would be a huge boost to the economy. I met today a representative, a trade representative from one of the regions of Russia called Tatarstan. It's a very dynamic, very modern region, and another interesting fact about that is it's predominantly Muslim region. It's like 500 miles from southwest of Moscow. I asked him, do you know about Belt and Road Initiative? He says, yes, I know very well. Why that? So there is a project in Tatarstan that is on the way between, if you put one of the lines connecting China to St. Petersburg and to Europe, Tatarstan would be on that way. And they started building a high-speed rail. It's a joint project by Russia and China with investments on both sides, and when it's completed in 2023, hopefully, it will connect Moscow to Kazan, the capital of Tatarstan. It's about 500 miles, and it will make it much more easier to travel between these two major cities. And from Kazan, it will go to Chelyabinsk, then to Kazakhstan, and then to China. I would also I agree completely with the previous speakers that the Belt and Road Initiative is not just economy, it's not just transportation. It's to put it simply, it's more stability. Because if we see less disparity in social economic development of different regions, different countries, that will make them more stable, and we will see less of radicalism, extremism, terrorism. We will see less of unregulated migration. So this will definitely be a factor that will stabilize the many regions in the world. And definitely Belt and Road Initiative will bring more exchanges, different kind of exchanges, scientific. When President Putin spoke at this Belt and Road International Forum lately, he said that Russia suggests to expand the practice of large international research facilities. We all know about the success of International Space Station that was a joint initiative on behalf of many countries, as well as CERN, nuclear research facility in Europe. So we can do many more things like that. And other exchanges, educational, cultural, sports, people to people. So all that is definitely good for Russia. And I will mention some other thing that that made this initiative even better for Russia. So if we can continue developing it, Russia will be one of the transit countries with many benefits from that in terms of just earnings, as well as developing regions of Russia, remote regions of Russia, right, like for example Siberia or Russian Far East. Then there is a thing that discussed now that is called cold of war, which means Arctic, which means that a maritime route that will connect China to Europe through the Northeast Passage. I spent many years in Canada when they were promoting their Northwest Passage. That will also, that could be a big booster for the economy of the North America, definitely. Giving you an additional way from the Atlantic to the Pacific, in addition to the Panama Canal. But for Russia, Northeast Passage that will go from the Pacific over the over Russia in the north, in the Arctic and Ocean, and to Europe, would be a great opportunity to develop the Russian northern regions, to involve them in this huge international trade that will be only growing. One more thing, we look forward, and that was part of the statements made by the two presidents of Russia and China, that the Russian and other states of the former Soviet Union initiative called Eurasian Economic Union and Belt and Road Initiative will work side by side. We look for harmonization of the interactions between these two projects, as well as definitely harmonization with the activities on that is happening now within the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, and lately we got a very, very important addition to this organization with India and Pakistan joining it after several years of being observers in it. I will also mention ASEAN, another big economic forum. we see it, it will connect Atlantic to the Pacific, the Atlantic Ocean to the Pacific Ocean. And we think that it's actually, we have to start thinking of a strategy of a very large Eurasian partnership that will include all these different processes. And like 200 years ago, when Russia traveled to Alaska and established this water tea route at that time, I'm sure that one day the idea of connecting two continents, Eurasian continent and North American continent, will happen. In the end, as I always say, the distance that divides Russia and the United States is very small. It's just 2.4 miles. Russia is the third nearest neighbor of the United States after Canada and Mexico. There are two islands in the Bering Strait called Diomede Island. One is big island, belongs to the US, I think, and one is small, belongs to Russia, but the distance between them is just 2.4 miles. So it's very close, we can build a bridge. So we welcome. We welcome One Belt, One Road initiative. We think that more discussions are necessary about how to more effectively put it into life. And I invite everybody to come to Russian Vladivostok for the Eastern Economic Forum that will happen this September, or even bigger forum that happens every year in St. Petersburg. It will be next May. Again, our support for One Belt, One Road is our long-term principled and strategic position. I'll finish with the words of my president. Let us pave these roads to development and prosperity together. Thank you very much.